Okay, let's get started. Hello, welcome. Hope you have a good day up to now. Yeah, my name is Roland Huss. I'm going to talk about Knative. I'm a software engineer working for Red Hat. And actually, I'm also working on Knative. So actually, I have more than half of my time I'm spending on working on Knative and on the client especially. So there's a CLI tool, which we will see later as well. Yeah, that's good. Or not so. I hope that video comes back soonish. Yeah, here. That was my computer. Okay, so yeah, let's get started. Knative is based on Kubernetes, but before we start to talk about Kubernetes, of course, first of all, my questions in the round, who does not know anything about Kubernetes? One, two. Who already use Kubernetes? And some, okay. So more than the half, this is good. So actually, I hope I have both for both of us, of you, something. Okay, so first of all, we are at a serverless conference. I don't want to go into any religious wars or something what serverless is and what serverless is not. So actually, what I'm doing here is I'm citing the CNCF, which has actually a definition of serverless. And I've put in some emphasis on my own and some de-emphases also as well. So actually, serverless in the context of Knative, so this is really serverless in a certain context. It really means about deployment of applications, and you do not require any server management to do on your own. Of course, there is some kind of server management somewhere in the background, but it's not something which you exposed to. And it's actually serverless is a deployment model, and it allows you some specialized features like being auto-scaled, like being very fine granularly built for certain stuff. And you really only pay for the demand which you have at the moment. So actually, this is really the full definition. It's already, yeah, it's 1 year old. So actually, I'm not sure whether there's an official kind of definition because many people think about different things when they are serverless. For example, that guy here is also someone who really has a different kind of definition of serverless, of course. And of course, maybe he's not wrong or right. So actually, in my opinion, it's just very, the definition is not very, very sharp. It's a bit blurry on this outside. So, and now we are really stopping about talking about the definition of what serverless is. So actually serverless in the sense of Kubernetes is about running containers. So container is a very important part of Knative. So you put your code into containers. Knative does not really care how you put your code into the container, but the lowest granularity, the smallest thing is a container. It's not a function, it's a container in this sense. Of course, you can put into your function into containers and then operate that on Knative, but we will all talk on the level of containers. And here is the yeah the text which Knative how Knative describes itself. So this was the original definition from Knative, which is about building, deploying, and managing serverless workloads. Actually, something happened in between. So Knative is not so old, it's only 1 year old. So it happened in the mid of 2018 when it was open sourced by Google. Some words on this in a second. But then the project evolved. So actually, there's not a GA version now. It's all still alpha and beta version. So there are still active, very active development and everything. APIs are changing. Not so much today anymore, but they have been changed in the last year. And then it turned out that this build part dropped off from Knative. The reason for that, so Knative also had a Knative build part, which was about how to you can directly also create your container images within Kubernetes itself. So it was you do not have to build your container images with a Docker daemon, for example, on your desktop or on your CI/CD pipeline. You do this within the Kubernetes cluster itself, or maybe in the same cluster which also runs your code. But then it turned out that many people are very interested in this aspect, and so they broke out this part and created a new project on top of that. And here you see again the original three pillars on which Knative was built at the beginning. It was serving and eventing, and this will be what we are talking about today in this talk. And there was this build part, and this is now replaced by a new project which is called Tecton Pipelines. And this is replacing Knative build totally. So you do not see anything of build within Knative anymore. You have sometimes, of course, if you look in the documentation and if the documentation has not been updated recently, then you will still have some references to Knative build. But the cool new stuff is Tecton Pipelines, which is also the first major project of the so-called CD, I think it's called CI/CD Foundation. So the whole foundation put around this project, and a lot of people are working on Tecton pipelines on companies like CloudBees, with Jenkins X, for example, is an implementation of Tecton pipelines and others. So, but this is all what I'm going to talk about, the build aspect today. Let's switch over to the other part, which is about serving and eventing. And serving is all about a request-driven model, which allows you to deploy easily your application, which is stuffed into a container image, onto Knative. And you are able to have various degrees of auto-scaling. You can scale down to zero, which means if there is no load coming to your service is not running. It's just down there, so it also doesn't cost you anything. But it also can auto-scale up to as much as you like. If you have a lot of load, if you have a spike in your usage patterns, then this scaling mechanism is very nice to have. And there are other features which we will see in detail in a second. And then there's a second part, which is about Knative eventing. And this is all about how these serverless workloads get their data from the outside and how they can get triggered. So Knative serving itself is all about HTTP connections, so about really connections with you for REST services coming in via HTTP, whereas eventing can have triggers for any kind of protocol. Okay, we have this talk has two parts, big parts. One is about serving and one is about eventing. Yeah, before I continue though, so this is a picture of a book I've written. So it has two purposes. Of course, it's a shameless plug. This is the first purpose for this picture. And the other thing is I just wanted in kind of anecdote that I had a chapter. There's one pattern which is about building stuff, and actually I describe Knative build in kind of a detail within this book, and you see how this book appeared in May this year. So the technology behind Knative is also moving quite fast. Yeah, so maybe what wasn't the best idea, but the rest of the book is still valid. So just in case you're interested. So it's all about using high-level patterns, how to use Kubernetes itself, not so much about Knative. Okay, some background information about Knative. I already mentioned that Knative has started as an open source project, has been open sourced by Google mid-2018, so last year. And there are a lot of, so it's a community and company-driven project, so a lot of companies are really working hand-in-hand together on Knative, like I'm working for Red Hat. But there are other people from IBM, from Pivotal, from Trigger Mesh, which is a smaller one, and also, of course, from Google. So there is some kind of a governance, but it's still driven by Google. So there's no neutral foundation around that. It's just driven by Google. At the moment, there are very many talks what happens with the future of Knative. So please watch out the news where it might move to. And then here you have some pointers. So it's all the source code is on GitHub. You have a documentation website, and actually there are working groups. I think there are seven. I'm not 100% sure whether it's really seven. And they are meeting weekly in half an hour. So if you're interested, so because it's a very young project, and if you kind of a coder and you like to work on Knative as well, it's still quite easy to make your dent into this project because it's still so young and you can easily. So for example, I started in April. I'm already the guy with the most commits in the Knative client project, so it's quite easy to ramp up on that one. So just in case you want to, of course, I forgot to say, it's all written in Go like Kubernetes. So if you're a Golang coder, then this might be of interest for you. And okay, I forgot to actually the serving is in 0.9, 0.10 is currently coming out. Eventing is a little bit behind. So in general, serving is a little bit more major than eventing. So all I'm showing you is a little bit. So eventing is still more moving parts. So the API might change even. Whereas for serving, it's quite stable, and you can expect that serving has a general GA, as a general availability. So the first major release within this year still. Whereas eventing a little bit later probably. Just to set the frame for that. Okay, this is about the condition around that. So then you say, okay, you are interested in Knative. If you want to try it yourself for Knative, you have several options to do so. There's a whole list of installation recipes, how you can install Kubernetes in Knative on a Kubernetes cluster. And of course, you have various ways how you can get your hands onto your Kubernetes cluster. We will show in the examples, we will use Minikube. in the case, but you can use any other Kubernetes cluster outside as well, like on Google Cloud, GKE or AKE, so whatever you want. Then there are other implementations of Knative or hosted services or also on premise. So one is Google Cloud Run. You might have heard about this. This was a product which has been announced also, I think earlier this year. And Google Cloud Run comes with two flavors. So one is a really totally hosted service. So this is something where you do not see anything about Kubernetes at all. So you only talk about the Knative API. So Knative has a set of APIs, which is typically implemented by Kubernetes. But this Google Cloud Run, this hosted version, is a very good example where you probably don't have Kubernetes underneath, but you don't know. You don't see anything about Kubernetes. So it's really something you give your container, and it looks like from the outside that you have an infinite large cluster where to deploy it. And it's probably some mixture between Kubernetes and App Engine, Google App Engine underneath, but you don't know. But the thing is, you pay per usage. For example, the good thing is there's a free tier, and they measure the usage by CPU seconds per month. CPU seconds per month. So you have 180,000 CPU seconds per month for free. Above that, you have to pay a little bit. And you have also 360,000 gigabytes seconds per month. So the usage that you can use. If you use 360,000 gigabytes for 1 second, you are done for the month. Yeah, you know. And if you, of course, you do not, you have spread this over the whole time, and then you have 2 million of requests, anfragen. Okay, sorry, about requests per month. There. Okay, this is a very very nice option to try it out yourself onto the Google Cloud. You can also install your own Knative installation on your own Google-hosted Kubernetes cluster. This is then Google Cloud Run on GKE or Ethos, as they call it. And finally, there's another product in the making, which is Red Hat OpenShift Serverless. So if you're a Red Hat OpenShift user, but is there anybody using OpenShift? Oh, there's one, okay. So Red Hat OpenShift is the enterprise distribution of Kubernetes sold by Red Hat. So this is the product. Yeah, question? Yeah, I will show you the Minikube installation here. And this is described in this document here. There are a lot of different options, like you can install it on various Kubernetes clusters on there. And this is in technical preview, so if you would have OpenShift, you can easily install it with an operator on OpenShift itself. So don't go into much details here. If you're okay, you see, and I expect that there will be many more product offerings on Knative itself. And the good thing is, of course, you see it already, you can take the application which you use to deploy on Google Cloud Run, you can take it unchanged, unaltered, and put it directly on Red Hat Shift Open Serverless. So it's really portable. You can move it around on different Knative installations. Okay, let's get started with serving. What is serving? So actually, this has more or less three features. So it says scale to zero. We will see that in action also in the demo. You can track different revisions of your application, so you can track the history of your application's configuration, and you can make a very flexible traffic split to your application between different revisions. So if, let's say you have version 1 and you have a version 2, and then you can flexibly configure simply how much traffic you want to route to which version. As I mentioned, the interest is, so you have the separation of code and configuration. It's clear because, okay, your code lives all in the container image, which comes from a Docker or from a container registry. And the configuration is just done within kind of a YAML file, like anything by Kubernetes. So everything in Knative is implemented via so-called custom resources, which is a kind of a new resource type, like which you can register for Kubernetes. So it's just a new type, and then it looks like Kubernetes descriptors like there. So if you have used Kubernetes, you might recognize the format at least. Autoscaling, I said, traffic splitting, but we see that all in action in a second. Then there's some restriction for your service. So it provides you a simplified deployment model, but it also requires that your application fulfills certain criteria. One thing is that it really communicates about HTTP. So this was something which was decided by Google before they made it open source. So these are the main major design decisions that they said, okay, the majority of services outside are HTTP based. And you offer a single port, so you access your service at a single port. You don't have access to persistent volumes, which makes it very easy to scale, of course. So it's all about for stateless workloads for the moment. So you put your state somewhere in another service behind it in a cloud service, like a Google SQL service or something else, somewhere else. But yours, the application which you're deploying on Knative, is stateless. And then it's a single container. So these are quite a lot of restrictions, of course, but again, a lot of applications fit into this category. And then, of course, again, if serving is the part which is called by which is used to consume the event which is produced or imported by Knative eventing. Okay, here we see a little bit of more technical details. So actually, these are what you see here are so-called resources, Knative resources or entities. So this is, if you know Kubernetes, this is the kind of the resource which you are using. You have a top-level resource which is called servers, and this is actually also the only resource which you are creating actually. And behind the scenes, then Knative, which is implemented as a set of operators running in Kubernetes itself, so they are watching all these resources all the time. They create so-called revisions. So you have a service is composed out of a route which specifies how your traffic is split over revisions, and a configuration which actually specify how your container should be created. So there, in the configuration, for example, you see all the environment variables which you set for your image container, and all the resource limits and all the other stuff which you typically put into a deployment in Kubernetes. And as soon as you change such a configuration, a snapshot has been done by the configuration and stored as a revision. So for every time you change the configuration, you get a new revision. And this revision is stacked above each other, so this is really your history. And so you can automatically roll back to a previous revision easily if, for example, you're making a mistake or an error in your configuration. It's quite easy because you can then adapt the route to say, okay, just put all the traffic on the revision just one day before, for example. Okay, important, so this is a little bit confusing. Service, actually there is a Kubernetes service as well. This was not my choice to call it service, but it's called also service, but with another so-called API group. So if you use kubectl, kubectl to check your Knative services, you typically don't use service because you would have to specify the full name, which is including the kind, which is service, plus the API group. You use a shortcut which is called ksvc. So this is you just say kubectl get ksvc for that. But this is the only entity which I really have to deal with. That's all actually for Knative serving. There are no more objects in that, and this is a this concept is quite—it's very easy, and you see, for example, here how it makes your life easier. What you see here, if you know Kubernetes, this is a so-called deployment, and this is only a small deployment. Actually, this can be pages long. Deployment is the resource which you give to Kubernetes if you want to instantiate an application. Underneath for deployment, Kubernetes will create replica sets, and then replica sets will create pods. So there's a lot of things layered above. So you have a lot of YAML, you see here, you have the specification, you have a template, which then again have another specification, and which finally then have somewhere the reference to your image. And this is the container image, which then is pulled from a registry and instantiated to a container. You specify the port. And now you can just take this deployment and just strip things away. So actually you can really leave out certain, like the replica set, remove it. The name, just remove it. You can really peel off certain amounts, and then you have just replaced the top-level thing, like the Knative serving, the kind, and the API version, like here. And this is what a Knative serving looks like. So it looks a little bit like a deployment, but with much less content inside. And plus, you actually for deployment, if you have application, you also have to, for example, not only have to specify a deployment, but also a service for getting your traffic into your deployment, and also if you come from the outside, an ingress object. So this is for you guys who know all your Kubernetes. You have to define multiple objects there. This is all not needed when you're using Knative. Okay, but a lot of words. Let's see that in action. Okay. So what I have here is it readable? So what I have here is a Minikube installation. So this is just installed after the installation document given on the Knative documentation side. this is all the namespaces. You see here that actually Knative itself needs Istio underneath, so actually, but not full Istio. It just uses the Istio gateway for making this traffic split part. So you can, and if you install that, so what I installed is called Istio Lean, so there's some kind of a stripped down Istio version which only has a minimal Istio. And the efforts are really to get rid of Istio altogether, to have Knative to be a standalone. So it's not so that Knative needs to be, so this was in the early times, everything you need full Istio and then Knative on top of it, and then you have such a big fat cluster, machine and minikube. This is much smaller these days. Okay, then you have certain namespaces where your operators are running in and Knative eventing and serving. I don't want to look into that. And then you have, yeah. And then what I have here as well installed is a Kafka message broker, but we will see that later when we are using eventing. Sure. Okay, then let's meet KN. KN is the CLI tool for Knative. So this is the part where I'm working on the project. And this is a little bit like kubectl, but for KN. So there's a one. First thing that you first has a noun and then a verb, and you just specify, for example, the name of your service, which is random in here, and then I specify a container image which I have prepared, which just is a REST service which returns your random numbers. So this is the idea of this demo service, and this is all what you have to do to just create this Knative service. So let's do that. So this happens also synchronous. So when your service is ready, then this command returns afterwards. So as the image has been already pulled, this can take a little bit longer if the image needs to be pulled from a registry. Actually, this has already been done. And then at the end, you see an URL. So for Minikube, this is just it's not a fake URL. It's a URL which is can be routed within Minikube. If you have a real cluster, you have really a full direct accessible URL which you can use directly on the command line. But in our case, I have to make some trickery, which is just I extract the IP from my Minikube, and then also from the Istio ingress gateway, which is exposed via NordPort. These are all technical details which are not very important. But I just take the Istio ingress gateway and have here this IP address. You see here, if I look, so actually I can access now the internal services or the service in there with this coordinates, and then I can use with curl. I have to specify a host header so that the gateway knows where to route to the service, and specify just this IP address just behind that. And you see that it's starting. And actually, in the top of the screen, you see already I have a watch on the ports which are running there, that there's constantly things coming and going. And the reason is, so when I create a new service, it first gets instantiated just to check whether everything is okay, so whether I can really instantiate it. But if I do not put any traffic onto the service, then it gets down immediately after 30 seconds. So this is configurable, of course. You can do this, but I think by default it's about 30 seconds without traffic. It scales down to zero. So if I wait a little bit here, so I made my request now, you will see this service going down as well. So this is quite nice. What I can do now as well is I can update this service. So, and you see that actually, let's see what has been created. So actually, I use kubectl in there. I have called command which is inspect, which is kind of a plugin to make it easier. I can use ksvc, and then the name of the service. And you see actually, this is was has been created. And if you do not have the client, you need to create that kind of YAML file on your own. Of course, not everything, because there are also sections with default values, but a lot of that stuff. And then you have the status, which also contains the URL here, and also some conditions. Okay, let's continue. Now you see in the top that it's already terminating, so because I didn't put any traffic onto it, so it goes down to zero. I can update --help. So what I want to do, I want to show you the concurrency scaling. So there's an option which is called concurrency limit. Service update, I chop it down, --- concurrency, update random, --, and not the image, so I just want to set the concurrency limit to 10, which means that I want to say that my service only should process 10 requests in parallel. After that, a new service should be scaled up. So this is just a way. Typically, you do not use that low number. You need a much, much higher number, of course. And the default number is 100, by the way. So actually, but to show you how it works, I just add that one. And now the service gets updated. Again, it just runs to check whether it works. I add a delay here as well. So actually, my container. So this is my own container's environment variable, which is evaluated to just pause for 1 second for each request. So this is something which is specific to my own random service. But it's just an environment variable which is set to the service. And now I can use, for example, here, let's maybe look 49. So hey is just a kind of a load generator, and we put it here onto this on that one. So we have it already on the unit here default, because I'm on the default namespace, and just let it run. And you will see immediately that this should scale up immediately, and it should scale up to, okay, these are six. So typically it should be 5, 50, 10. So this, okay, the options here say -c is the concurrent numbers of requests put by this load generator, and n is the total number of requests sent to the generator. But you see now it has been scaled up. It's running, and it's as soon when this is finished, it scales down again. So this is really where this scale to zero and scale up to certain limit. You can also specify how many at max. You can say a max scale to say, okay, I don't want more than 10. You can also specify a min scale. You can say min scale equals to 1, which means that your service is running all the time. If you want to save the cold start costs, which you always have, if you start from zero to something, it's not immediately. So the first request always takes several seconds because the container needs to spin up. But if you do not want this, and you can always keep one container up and running all the time, but you have to pay for this, of course, for all the time. So this is all the trade-off which you have here. So okay, let's stop that here again. Come on. Okay, then you have here. This should go down no soon. KN service describe random. You can use that to see all the active revisions. So you see here actually that you have a revision which is called like that. And we want now, let's say we update it and we give it this revision a name. So we say minus tag, and this is actually this revision name. As you remember, revision is just a snapshot of your configuration. And we say this is the version 1 we have. If you see it again, we see it that you have a version 1 thing. And everything is going now to latest. And this is typical behavior of Knative. So if you deploy something, it always puts by default 100% of the traffic to the latest deployed version. And now let's say we make an update here to KN service update random -- image, now version 2. And now we say we want to the latest 50% and to the last version 50% as well. So, but typically you would do, we want to try out, so this is a kind of a canary release, you want to try out only maybe 10% for or 1% of your newest release and 90% of your old release, and then you can switch over at any time to the 100%. So let's, but for the sake of the demonstration, let's use 50-50, so that when we make a request on the on that, you will see that it gets distributed evenly over the different versions. We can again verify here. Now you see that your 50% are going to the latest version, which is random 2. And then we have 50%, which is V1, which is here is a very lengthy number. So this is a little drawback of, this is can be done nicer from the client part. But it means if you make an update on your configuration and you do not want to, let's say, let me step back. So if you have a Docker image or container image, you typically have a tag, which is V1, V2. But this is not really a version. You can change this tag anytime. You can always change it, and then you have a different kind of, even for another container. To avoid the effect that if you change maybe something in the environment, and somebody else has, for example, updated V1 onto the registry, and you just fetch in also the new image, not only the update of your environment variable, but also a new image there, to avoid the situation, it's really an image as soon as it's pushed, and you do not change the image during an update, is pinned to its digest. So it has a sum there. So you can be guaranteed that if you change anything else other the image, you get the same image back again, which you had before, even if somebody else would have changed the tag within the registry. So this is an implementation detail, and that's the reason why this looks so lengthy here. Okay, sorry, now before I run out of time, let's make a curl here. So, okay, you see we are down now, we have to start up a new service, so we have version 2.0. Again, you see a second one, now this is on our other version, the other revision. And you see now that it's really distributed, obviously you see the versions, actually I encoded the version here in the image here at the last part, so sorry, I forgot that. So you have 2.0, you have here 1.0, and if I go again, then again 2.0. So this nearly 50-50, so it's equally distributed over things. And yeah, you can now switch back again everything, so we can say, for example, service update, now we do not change the image, we just want to have the latest traffic to be now 100% again, and now everything goes to the newest version. So this is the way how it deals, and everything is done behind the scenes within by Knative, by reconfiguring the Istio gateway, so all the stuff is done transparently for you without you doing anything else. So I hope I could convince you that the serving part, together with the CLI client, is really nice and easy to use. And this is also the experience you have if you run this on Google Cloud Run, for example, and other hosted offers. So this is all about you to only have to specify really this high-level parts. Okay. Next step. Now, let's see. Okay, we have half an hour, that's good. Eventing, the other part. So we have seen now Knative serving, how it deals with scaling, with traffic splitting, with revision handling. But it's all about HTTP services, and it's all what we did. We used a curl or a browser to request the REST service and get the response back. But actually, for a fast like scenario, so serverless is not. I wanted to avoid the word fast in the context, but actually, my opinion, one of the biggest strengths of functions as a service is really, if you run it in an ecosystem like AWS or Google Cloud, you have this immense set of services which you can use for. So actually, the immense of triggers you can, you get your function can get over 60 triggers. I don't know how many from AWS, but actually, this is the richness of this ecosystem, and actually. This is where eventing kicks in. So this allows you how you can subscribe for different kind of events and feed in your services with these events. Okay, some of the high-level key features from Knative Eventing is it's all about event orchestration, that you really do everything again declaratively. You declare your event sources, as we will see, so where you get your events from. You also declare where you want to put the events to. Everything is based on cloud events. Cloud events is a CNCF standard. So actually, this is a kind of a format how events are transported into via HTTP. So the cloud events is also based on HTTP and also on GCP. Not only on HTTP. There are other transport protocols as well. But actually, this is the standard, and this is the standard that's underlying on below Knative Eventing. So every time you get some events for Knative Eventing, it's a cloud event. And you have different kind of internal transport channels. So you can, depending on your requirements, you can use just transport the events from your source to your service directly within memory, so without any guarantees no performance guarantees or other guarantees. But you can also use a full-blown messaging system behind for this channel, like Kafka or GCP PubSub, for example. Okay, so the first part is event sources. And event sources is all about, so it's not really, so there was some heated discussion about the name of this term, source. Because when we talk about Knative sources, eventing sources, it's not really the source of the event, it's more or less like an adapter which takes your event which comes from elsewhere and transform it into cloud events and moves it on to a Knative service. So then they removed sources to the name importer. So it was called Knative Eventing Importer. But then it turned out that nobody has been using the word importer. Everybody was already used to sources all the time, so they switched back to sources. Now the official name for this thing is, again, Knative Sources. And again, as Knative Eventing Source, anything else is also declared via a custom resource. So you just declare. You have for every type of creative eventing source, that you have a different custom resource with a different type. And then this type, you deploy that, for example, for Kafka, you would just have a Kafka source kind of YAML file. You put this to Knative, and then in the background, an operator which is running just make the connection to your existing Kafka cluster and just pulls all the messages from a topic directly to the connected other parts of your Knative eventing. Yeah, so the source is free, whether it uses pull-based or push-based. And again, one of the main duties of such a source is that it transforms a custom event format to a cloud event. What kind of eventing sources already exist? There exist quite some of them. So there, for example, there's a simple one which is called Cronjob. And this is just a timer which schedules to a fixed interval. So you give a Cronjob entry, and then every time the schedule fires, it fires fixed constant data into your Knative eventing system. You have also API server cron source, which is about just refeeding Kubernetes events into Knative eventing. So it just puts every time you create a pod or an event, it just creates a new cloud event and give that to your Knative services. So this is, we will see in a demo in action in a second, if you have enough time. And then you have also the way that you can use a container source, which is just an image you have prepared, and this is just called, and your container can do anything what it wants to, but it needs to just put a cloud event data to a given URL at the end. So you can easily write your own source by just creating or preparing a container image. There are a lot of documentation how this can be done easily. Yeah, so this would be one of the ways how you can put in your custom, maybe proprietary event source into Knative eventing. Then there's one about GitHub, so you can register for GitHub webhooks and you get all the classical GitHub style events as well into Knative eventing. You can use Kafka, as I mentioned, so you can transform any Kafka message into a cloud event and move on with that. And then there's one very interesting event source, which is called SCAMLK. Anybody knows SCAMLK? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's cool. So SCAMLK is an enterprise application integration library. So this is a Java library, which has around over 200 components, which connects to different external systems like Twitter, like Trello, like SAP, like Conqueror. So all the REST APIs which are out there, or any other APIs like FTP, anything you can imagine, there's a component within SCAMLK which can connect to this component. You have to provide your credentials, of course, but it connects and knows how to speak that kind of protocol. And this SCAMLK component can use all of these components and transform the data again in cloud events and put it into Knative eventing. So this is a little bit, the setup is a little bit more involved, but actually you have a very rich ecosystem of already existing components. And if you want, for example, to write a Twitter source, you just probably would use SCAMLK and the Twitter component to connect this to Knative eventing. There are many others as well, especially proprietary ones, like for Google Cloud, of course, there are event sources for PubSub and other, and also for their, I've forgotten how their bucket store is called, but there are all these sources are available as well, and you see the list there behind this URL. But again, you can write your own custom eventing source, like really write it really like from scratch, so really the hard way. So you create you write an own operator, you write an own CRD, and deploy that on the cluster. This is really a lot of work, but then it looks like any other of the Cronjob, any other of the eventing sources on the list above. And then you can use this container source I already mentioned, but you could also talk directly to the broker. So the broker, which we'll see later, is just a service running in the background, listening on an port with HTTP, and this broker expects cloud events, and it takes the cloud events and moves it on to all the subscribed services as well. So you could do this as well. Okay, now I said it's all about connecting sources to services, and there are several ways how you can do this in Knative eventing. This is the simplest way. Every source has a field which is called sync, and in the sync you can specify the name of a Knative service, which means anytime an event which happens for the source, which is pulled by the source or obtained by the source, is then moved on to this service. And again, it's just a HTTP post call with the cloud event data as a payload. This is quite easy, but it has a lot of drawbacks, of course. Actually, your service needs to be available at the time when the event occurs, or your source itself needs to have some kind of queuing implemented. Of course, your source can be as sophisticated as you want it to be, but typically you do not want to put too much burden on the source. So you could actually put into your source a full messaging broker as well to allow queuing of events which could not be delivered, that you could react on back pressures if your service is not fast enough to process the data, for example. And another more general restriction is that only one service can connect to the source in this way. So only one service can obtain the events, which is of course not useful in every case. And then there's another final problem that you cannot filter. So your service gets all events, but maybe your service is only interested in a subset of the events which is produced by the specific source. Okay, but this is, as I mentioned, this is the easiest one, and this is what I want to show you first to get a feeling of Knative Eventing. So first let's create, so K is my shortcut for kubectl. I create just a new namespace for let's call it source demo. Then kube namespace is a nice little tool to pin your namespace so that you can, that all your operations are working on that one. So you probably already know that. Okay, now we're in a new empty namespace in Kubernetes. It's empty. And the first thing we need to do is, of course, to install a service, which then will consume our data. There is one, again, I use my my KN command line tool, and I use an image which is called event display. And this is a very simple consumer for events because it just takes the event and prints it out to console, to the log. So this is all that we see. So typically, of course, your service would do something more intelligent with the data it receives, but in our case, we just print it out. Okay, let's create that. Okay, so it's running, but it will disappear soon. Then I have here, let's use a Kafka source. So what you see here, now let me use a different tool, that's a little bit nicer. So this is what I'm going to send now to the Kubernetes cluster here, to my minikube. So the important part here is, so the important part is this kind, which actually really specifies which source, type of source you want to create. And then you have, of course, need the connection parameter to your Kafka cluster. So there's already a Kafka cluster running on my minikube. So if I say minishift minikube, I confuse it always. Minishift is the same like minikube, but for OpenShift. So just to be clear. Okay, minikube. And then I have to specify the topic which I want to monitor. So every topic on the Kafka cluster, in that case, there's a topic demo. And if there is a new message in this demo topic, it will be picked up by the source and then put to my event display because I put the sync here directly to my service. So you see, I have here my service. This is the eDisplay, like I called it here above. This is a service with the API version. And what happens is really I just feed the events directly into the service. Okay, let's create that. Kubectl create minus f Kafka source. Oops. Yeah, thanks. So now you see that there's something new appears here. It's a new pod. And this is actually this Kafka application, which runs all the time. So this does not scale down. But this is the one which really monitors my Kafka broker and connects to the Kafka cluster here. And then I have my service, but actually there's no topics in there. So in order to feed the Kafka cluster here, I have a simple, it looks complicated, but it's simple. minus, so I have to. So what I'm doing here, exactly. So here, what I'm using here, I have here a so-called WebSocket Kafka bridge, which also has been written by us, but actually connects to a WebSocket, which is some, this is a university, is a service provided by the University of Newcastle, and where they expose all the IoT data to the outside. So actually, this is a very good test case for if you want to get many, many data, many, many events. And this is, of course, has a custom format. And what this image does is just it connects to the web service, picks up this event stream coming from the from this REST service, and puts it into a topic which is called Kafka Demo, which is called Demo on the Kafka service. So this has nothing to do with native eventing. It's just there to fill to feed my Kafka broker with messages. So just doing that. Okay. Now the bridge is created, and now a lot of things should happen now. So it's creating, and as you see immediately, my Knative service pops up because there are now events in the thing. So the Kafka source calls my service. My service was scaled down to zero. And because there's data, there's load, then the service comes up. So this also means if there are no events outside, because you're listening, for example, on an F3 bucket or something like that, and nobody puts in some file, you do not pay anything because your service is not running. It just wakes up when you get some data. Okay, now let's see what's coming in there. I probably should. So I use Stern. Stern is also a tool for kubectl for using printing out logs a little bit. So you see they're coming on a lot of data. Maybe I just stop that. Maybe I just should delete the pod here, because otherwise I get topic overload. Takes a little bit, so let's see it again. And let's scroll back. So what do you see here is now what you see a lot of events coming in. Let's pick one of them. So it's a cloud event. A cloud event has a header, metadata, which is called the context attributes, which comes in that case, in Knative eventing case, is HTTP headers to your service. It has a Knative event, has also a type, which is important when we later look at triggers. And you have a content type, of course, and some other stuff. And then there are also cloud event specific headers, but I don't see anything here. And then there's data. And data is just arbitrary payload. In that case, it's a JSON structure, which is specific to this REST service from the University of Newcastle. And what we see here is some switch electricity meter, and this has the value of that. Okay, you see, it's just data, which you can get in, but it's all coming in from the outside. Can I just put it to my service? And if you wait, okay, we already see here that as there are now no new events anymore, my service is going down again. Okay. Yeah, this was this kind of direct connection. So, but as I mentioned, this is not the best possible way to do so. So first of all, let me change back to the default namespace and then delete namespace, however I called it, source demo, I think. Yeah, okay, back to the slides. Okay, how can we do better? Okay, then there's the next concept, which is called a channel. So a channel is a new entity which is running as well by Knative, so it's also a type which is called channel, and a channel can be addressed by any source. So instead, in the sync part which we've seen, which has addressed a service, can also address a channel as well. So instead of service, there would be channel, and many sources can address the same channel. And then there's a new object also called subscription, and this subscription has two ends. One is pointing to a service, and the other one is pointing to the channel. And then everything which is coming from the source is going to the channel, and every service running connected to the channel via a subscription gets these events. So you have an end-to-end kind of relationship between source and service now. And your channel implementation also determines the quality of your event delivery. So actually, if you're in our case, it's a simple case. I've used the in-memory channel, so everything goes through memory. So it's not really any production ready thing, but it's very good for demos, of course, and for development. But you can use also Kafka backed channel, which stores all the events coming in, but the sources also by within Kafka itself, which is then, only for the channel, but you can also use GC PubSub, and there's some kind of API, so you can write your own channel implementation if you want to. But it's complicated, but you can do. And so you can have any of the guarantees like queuing, like maybe if you want, like queuing, you can use that. You have guaranteed delivery maybe, and all the other guarantees which your messaging broker offers. But another, there are still some drawbacks here. So one thing is that you have to now to create subscription channel as well. You have to take care about all these new objects, so it looks much more complicated. You can make this very arbitrary. What I have not shown here is that the service also can return a new event. It can consume events, but in the HTTP response, you can also have a new cloud event. And what to do with this cloud event? This is then going to the subscription back. So the subscription can specify a reply channel, so this return value from the service goes into the reply channel. This can be the same channel like this one, but it can also be another channel. So you can, if you look on the next slide, you can do this in very complicated ways. You can set up whole chains of channels. You can connect services, subscribe to them. It doesn't have to be linear like this. So it's quite complicated in this sense. But it's also very mighty, of course. So, but again, now let's directly jump to the third option, which is typically the one which people use today, which is using a broker and a trigger. So we have seen the channel. So here you don't see any channels, but behind the scene there are channels now. So all the communications, all the lines are eventually backed by channels. But you have here a source, and this is connected now to a broker. Broker is also a central entity running in Knative. You will see an example in a second. And this runs there, and you can many sources can connect to the broker. And the important part is that these events have also types. We have already seen one of the types here. And this type has a meaning now with the broker, because a service can now subscribe to a broker with a trigger. And with a trigger, you can specify a filter. You can say, I want only events of that type, like only events of the blue type or events of the red type. And then the service, of course, only gets the blue or red events. And and the broker will create channels behind the scenes. So actually, the broker has a channel template. And every time a new trigger registers at the broker, then a new channel gets implicitly created by the broker itself. So it's not something you have to do on your own. This is done by the broker for you. And yeah. Let's see exactly. Okay, one final thing. If the service has a return value, so it can return one event, it can also return multiple events, it goes back to the broker and it's distributed again to other services there. So you can just distribute, can connect to other services via the broker as well. Did I mention everything here? Exactly, except that the reply is always to the broker. With the reply channel, you can address not only another channel, you could also theoretically address other service, for example. A so-called addressable, which is a kind of, in Knative sense, it's called a duck type. It's something, so you know what a duck type is? So duck type is called, if it looks like a duck, if it smells like a duck, it's a duck. So it's a kind of interface which is not explicit. So you, in the end, any object which has a status field with an URL can be used as a target of anything of that. So you can just use this kind of addressable thing in there as well. So this is just for the implementation details here. Genau, okay. But demo is good. Let's see how much. Oh, 5 minutes only. Let me hurry up. Okay. Kube control. Create. Let's make a namespace. Broker demo. No. This is okay. Kube namespace. Namespace broker demo. Okay. Again, we have no service list. We don't have any services. We need event display service, which is actually our consumer. In the case, we create that. Then we need a source. So in this case, we do not use now the Kafka source. We use the API server source, which just picks up the Kubernetes API server events and feeds it as cloud events into Knative. So, but to do that, I need to fix some permissions. So this is just for the sake of the demo. Ignore the errors. And now let's see the API server source. So what we see here now, we have here the API server source. Give it a name, a service account which is using. And sorry. And then we have we list which kind of resources we want to watch. So in that case, we want to watch pods. So every time a pod is created or is deleted, we want to get an event. And that this is what I specify here. And then I have again this thing, which in this case is not a service, but it's a broker. So it's going to a broker. But before I can create it, I need to create the broker itself. And this is typically done. So this is one trick in Knative. So you label your namespace with a certain label. Here it's Knative eventing injection enabled. And if I do so, then the operator in the background, you see, will fire up a broker for my namespace. So a broker is namespace specific, typically. It's always every namespace has an own broker. And you see here now the broker is running. And now I can create my API server source. So, and you see now again an own deployment for the source is running as well, which is just picking up the API events here. I have now my Knative service, I have my source, I have the broker. The only thing which is missing is the trigger. I need a trigger which connects my service to the broker. So, let's see what I have here. Sorry, API server trigger at. So what I have here, I have a trigger which has a filter now, which only wants to receive events of the type add. So it only wants to have events when a pod gets added. And I want to move that onto the service display. So let's create that. This was API server trigger add. Oops. Okay. Again, nothing happens because I do not create any pod yet. So what I do need to do now is to create a pod to trigger an event, which then gets delivered to my service. Let's do that again with a kubectl run command. In that case, I'm just using again my random server. So I'm just creating a single pod in Kubernetes. It's coming here. And you see immediately now my eDisplay service is also starting again because I just started this part here. And I can, let's run it into the background. And you see here now that what I got now with my eDisplay service. Let me, oh, it's a little bit lengthy. Come on. Here we go. So here with the cloud event, the usual headers, and then the data is just the pod declaration for the pod which has been created. You see here, for example, the name is eDisplay, so actually also gets events for its own service, of course. Now, this was the event which was for the creation of the thing for this eDisplay service pod. And now let's just delete pod random as well. And I have the same trigger now for remove as well. And now a nice thing happens. I have now created this delete. I have no time to show it you here. But now if the eDisplay pod goes down because it's scaled down to zero, the pod gets deleted, the event gets triggered, the source picks it up, sends it back, and the service jumps up again. Because, yeah, pod has been deleted at the way. So maybe we can see that. So maybe you have seen here already. So it went down, it went up again. So this you can make kind of a, can shoot yourself in the foot. So okay. let's keep that running. So actually, finally, some words of the things which I have not shown you for eventing. There's even more a little bit. You have an event registry where you can register event types, and your triggers can you can look them up from there to find out which triggers are available. So you can set up your filters for that. You have the possibility to create sequences, which is quite services step after each other, and which also are connected like with automatically with via channels. So you can make a sequence, which means the output of one service is the input of the next service in the sequence. So you can change them easily. And then there is also a parallel construct, which allows you branching. So you can split up an event into multiple branches so that multiple services get the same event. And you can also put fillers on that, so you can realize you can create conditional processing like that. So you say, okay, I only want to go on if this certain attribute happens there. Okay, now I'm at the end. Yeah, what I hope what I could show you that the Knative Serving really simplifies the deployment. So if this client tool is eventually ready, you really don't have to deal with any YAML files, and we hope we can be as powerful that everything can be done via the command line tool. We could show that it's really quite easy, that all the aspects like traffic splitting, scaling, and also the revision handling like rollback can be done via KN. Traffic splitting is very, very flexible, and also you can use it for custom rollout and rollback scenarios. Eventing, there is also something in the pipeline for the client tools. Actually, we are already just starting up for providing the same support for this client like we do for serving, also for eventing, like that you can create your sources directly with KN. You have then KN, source, create, Kafka, for example, and then all the options which are specific to Kafka to create your API source instead of creating the YAML files. It's based on Clause Event, and you can use also factory standards like Kafka for your messaging needs and setup. And yes, and that's all I have for now. And I thank you very much for your attention.